fractures in patients with chronic kidney disease. Importance of fracture, especially in elderly people and more so in patients with chronic kidney disease. It occurs in about one third of women on the whole worldwide, and 1 in 5 women. And the 1 year mortality rate following hip fracture is about 20%. And 1/3 of them who return home following fracture still continue to require other people's support for having an active life. So the stages of CKD. Next slide. You can see the fracture rate in women who are more than 65 years who have stage 5 CKD, GFR less than 15 ml per minute. About 10% incidence is noted in the 3-year period. And the same in the age group of 40 to 65 years, the average incidence is about 5. Among men with stage 5 CKD, about 6% of them develop a fracture over 3-year period when they have stage 5 CKD. And among the men who are aged 40 to 65 years, about 3% of them have fracture over a 3-year period. And, fractures happen even in patients who are not on dialysis. And the fracture in patients with CKD happens even at an younger age compared to those who don't have chronic kidney disease, and they have a higher mortality following a fracture compared to the other group of people who don't have chronic kidney disease. Why is that the patients with CKD have more fractures? There are several factors. One, they have disorders of bone turnover and mineralization. They have hyperphosphatemia, hyperparathyroidism. They have vitamin D deficiency. They have chronic acid loads, chronic acidosis, which is being buffered in the bones. So this leads to weakness of the bones. They have sarcopenia and frailty, as discussed by our previous speaker, Dr. Anand. And they are exposed to both glucocorticoids due to their underlying chronic kidney disease. They have hypogonadism and physical inactivity, as stressed upon in the previous talks. These are all the reasons why patients with chronic kidney disease have more of fractures. And there are two processes in patients with chronic kidney disease that contributes to the fractures. The first is CKD mineral bone disease. The second is osteoporosis that happens in the general population also, that is more prevalent in patients with CKD. The differentiation is important because the management of these two processes is different. Now, what is osteoporosis? It's defined by NIH as a skeletal disease characterized by compromised bone strength, predisposing a person to an increased risk of fracture. And who defined it as a T-score of -2.5 or below with a bone mineral density measured by dual energy X-ray absorptive. So, whereas chronic kidney disease, mineral bone disease, it is characterized by laboratory abnormalities involving calcium, phosphorus, parathyroid hormone, and vitamin D, bony abnormalities including turnover, mineralization, and volume, and also vascular calcification. All these three contribute to CKD mineral bone disease. And these two processes should be differentiated in treating or preventing fractures in chronic kidney disease. The turnover in patients with chronic kidney disease can be low or high. High turnover bone disease is called osteomyelitis fibrosis. If on low turnover, the extreme end is adynamic bone disease. And identifying the bone turnover in patients with CKD is important in preventing fractures in this group of population. This is the low turnover bone disease characterized. Examples are adynamic bone disease and osteoporosis. High turnover characterized by osteomyelitis fibrosis. The most common, however, is a mixed turnover bone disease. Conventional tools to predict fracture are FRAX, CRORE, and DEXA scan. But whether can this be applied in patients with chronic kidney disease? Fracture risk assessment tool, it takes into account the age, the gender, weight, height, the risk factors, the previous history of the fracture, the parents having a fracture, current smoking, glucocorticoid use, presence of rheumatoid arthritis, and alcohol intake of more than 3 drinks per day. Femoral link BMD as measured by DEXA scan. But this fracture school assessment tool does not include GFR, which is a very important factor though. So for example, a 60-year-old female who has rheumatoid arthritis and has a previous history of fracture, there is a 21% risk of developing a fracture in the next 10 years. Whereas if she does not have rheumatoid arthritis or no previous history of fracture, the fracture risk of a major fracture is about 10%. This tool is used to predict, is widely used to predict fractures in the general population. Whereas in CKD, it does not include adjustment, this tool does not have a GFR criteria, which is also, but a low GFR also increases the risk of fractures. So we have to adjust the absolute fracture risk to a higher level, approximately double when the GFR is less than 60 ml per minute for 1.3 this one. The DEXA scan, when the T score is between -1 to -2.5, it is called as osteopenia. When it is more than -2.5, it is osteoporosis. And the T score falls more than -2.5, of course, it is said to have osteoporosis. And there is a gradual rise in increased incidence of fracture overall, the raising DEXA scans, raising DEXA scan scores. Now, why do the bones break? This, when the load applied to the bone is higher than the bone strength, the bone breaks. And what determines the bone strength is the bone density and mineralization. These two things are measured by the DEXA scan, but the bone turnover and the architecture is not measured by the DEXA scan. But bone so these two are also important in chronic kidney disease, where it is also involved in CKD. So the usual DEXA scan may not be of much, may not be helpful in chronic kidney disease because it does not determine the other two factors. And patients with CKD have a preferential loss of cortical bone, which is not preferentially measured with the DEXA scan. It measures the bone strength of the trabecular bone, motor donor. And patients with chronic kidney disease, they may have high turnover bone disease or low turnover bone disease. But both of this increase risk of fracture independent of the bone mineral density measurement by the DEXA scan. And the height and the bone turnover diseases like osteoporosis, osteomalacia, adynamic bone disease, secondary hyperparathyroidism, all this high or low turnover bone disease can have a low value of low DEXA scan scores irrespective of, and it does not differentiate between these parameters. So does this mean bone mineral density testing by DEXA scan is not clinically useful? But it's not the case. In patients with stage 1 to stage 4 CKD, when the GFR is more than 30 ml per minute, in the absence of metabolic abnormalities of calcium, phosphorus or parathyroid hormone, still DEXA scan is helpful in this group of patients. And when the DEXA scan not probably of not of use when the GFR is less than 30 ml per minute. And when a patient has stage 5 or stage 5 on dialysis with CKD, they have profound alterations in mineral metabolism resulting in CKD anemia with or without decreases in bone mineral density. And distinguishing low turnover bone disease from other forms of bone mineral disease is important because we usually administer anti-resorptive agents. This will further aggravate the low turnover bone disease in this group of patients. And in patients with stage 3 to stage 5 CKD, it may be reasonable to perform a bone biopsy, but it requires specialized expertise to read the bone biopsy, and so it is difficult to do it in all ideal settings. So there are some non-invasive assessments of bone turnover, include eye parathyroid hormone, intact pH, and bone specific arterial phosphatase. This may be a clue to identify low turnover bone disease without a bone biopsy. They may be applied if you cannot use a bone biopsy. You cannot do a bone biopsy. The treatment for renal osteodystrophy is aimed at correcting the underlying mineral and hormonal abnormalities, usually focusing on phosphate binders and vitamin D analogs. But in low turnover bone disease, anti-resorptive medication should be avoided. The osteoporosis management includes bisphosphonates, denosumab, raloxifene and teriparatide. Short thing about these medications in chronic kidney disease. Bisphosphonates The most commonly prescribed treatment for osteoporosis, oral bisphosphonates used are alendronate and acetronate, and zoledronic and citronic bisphosphonate. Alendronate and zoledronic acid, they are contraindicated when the creatinine clearance is less than 25 ml per minute, and acetronate is contraindicated when GFR is less than 30 ml per minute. And when a patient reaches stage 3 chronic kidney disease, a 50% reduction in dose is recommended in this the dosing of bisphosphonates. Denosumab is an anti-resorptive agent for osteoporosis. It is not eliminated by the kidneys, so no dose reduction is required in patients with chronic kidney disease also. But the important side effect is hypocalcemia, which is more commonly observed in patients with chronic kidney disease. Raloxifene is a selective estrogen receptor modulator. That is an option to prevent vertebral fractures in postmenopausal women, but not much studies or data is present in patients regarding this medication use in chronic kidney disease, especially in dialysis. And teriparatide is an anabolic product for osteoporosis, which works to increase the osteoclast activity by mimicking the actions of intact parathyroid hormone. It may be helpful in patients with adynamic bone disease. How to prevent fractures in patients with chronic kidney disease? First is to prevent vitamin D deficiency. So we measure 25 hydroxy vitamin D levels. If they are low, we need to correct it. The other thing is, even though they may have normal levels of 25 hydroxy vitamin D levels, because the kidney has to convert it to 125 hydroxy vitamin D. So even having a normal 25 hydroxy vitamin D may not be enough, so we may need to supplement with 125 hydroxy vitamin D, which is calcitriol, especially if the patient has hyperparathyroidism and hypocalcemia. We need to correct hyperphosphatemia, which is with phosphate binders like calcium acetate or calcium carbonate and sevelamer carbonate. We need to correct hyperparathyroidism. Acidosis should be corrected in chronic kidney disease because the acid is being buffered in the bone. If you prevent acidosis, we may preserve the bone strength to a certain extent. We need to improve nutrition as expressed with the previous speaker. It improves the muscle mass and prevents frailty. We should promote activity and exercise. And the FACTS scoring can be applied in patients with CKD, but the risk needs to be doubled when the patient has stage 3 to 5 chronic kidney disease. The DEXA scan, which is of value in patients who have stage 1 to stage 4 chronic kidney disease. Bone biopsy, if it is possible, and if you are not able to do a bone biopsy, we can think about IBPH or bone-specific alkaline phosphatase. To rule out low turnover bone disease before administering anti-bisphosphonates. Bisphosphonates can be used in stage 1 to stage 3 chronic kidney disease. It can be used in stage 4 CKD also after ruling out low turnover bone disease. We should remember a 50% dose reduction is required in bisphosphonates if a patient is beyond stage 3 chronic kidney disease. Denosumab, teriparatide can also be used, but they are costlier options. Thank you. Any questions, sir?
Yes, sir. In general about fractures, Pediatric Society of India, of which I have been the president, we have issued guidelines on the bathrooms and latrines, how you should be organized. That is, by the toilet you are sitting by the side when you can reach 2 feet height. Normal railings are 2.5 feet. 2 feet height, that should be railings on both sides. And also entrance and exit. Second thing, no self-locking doors. Doors should be openable from both sides. You can go to the internet, get all the things. One day all of us are going to be born.
Now I request Dr. Chandrasekhar to hand over the certificate of appreciation.